These objects are everywhere. Many are vital for industry, and many quietly ensure our daily well-being. Some keep us healthy, and others, when all other hopes are crushed, can even save lives. And many are also legacies of the past. But if they are mistreated, or if they are lost, they can take your health, or even your life. They are radioactive sources. A chance to encounter one is much higher than you may think. And so, in today's episode, we will tell you essential facts that you better know about them. This is the beginning of a new series on radiological accidents around the world, beyond Chernobyl. And as you will see, many of those incidents happened only because the people involved didn't know the details you will learn today. If you think this problem could never touch you, let me share a story I personally witnessed. So, my friend had a lot of parrots, and one day he got one more. He kept it in a separate cage standing on a cupboard, and for the first weeks everything seemed fine. But after a while, the bird began to act strange. It became restless, nervous, constantly scratching, plucking at feathers until bald patches appeared. And so he took it to a vet, but they couldn't find the actual cause, because the other parrots in the same room were absolutely healthy. Yet the strange condition continued, and about a year later, the parrot was gone. And I guess you already see where it is coming. One day, I visited them when I noticed a large marine clock on the corner wall next to the cupboard. It looked just like this, but its glass was cracked with a piece missing. My friend told me it was brought by his grandfather and had hung there for decades. By then, I was already working in Chernobyl, and so one glance was enough for me to take out the dosimeter I always carry. This is because clock's hands and numerals were coated with the distinctive brownish paint made with radium, once luminous, but then long faded. Yet from the dial came a narrow, forward-peaked beam of gamma radiation, fading with the distance, but still detectable even a couple of meters away. Luckily it was directional, and because of the clock's position, people could not cross it. But exactly on that axis, less than 30 centimeters or 12 inches away, was where the parrot's cage had stood. Well, it was not extreme, not enough to cause any radiation sickness. But for a small bird, constantly in that very spot, it was a chronic dose well above the ground. Enough high to be a serious stressor, one that contributed to its illnesses that eventually shortened its life. If not the circumstances, this situation could develop much worse, because radium dials are far more dangerous than most people think, and many of them still hang unnoticed in homes and collections. Radium, discovered by Marie and Pierre Curie, is thousands times more radioactive than uranium of the same mass. But due to its chemistry, if ingested or inhaled, the human body mistakes it for calcium, and so a major amount of radium accumulates in bones. There it eventually becomes a permanent internal radiation source, which is much more damaging than any external exposure. But in early 20th century, a few knew this. Radium became a fashionable miracle substance. Just imagine, radium cosmetics or radium-containing toothpaste, even radium drinks. Yet, besides all that, there was made a useful invention, luminous paint, a mixture where radium particles strike a zinc sulfide phosphor to create a constant glow. It became widely used for marking switches, door signs, and dials, basically anything that had to remain visible in the darkness. But the danger became gradually clear only in the early 1930s, after female workers who painted watch dials at United States Radium Company began to become more and more sick. I recommend reading this book if you are interested in their story. But to be short, those ladies, today known as the Radium Girls, suffered truly horrifically. They had their teeth falling out, non-healing wounds, bone fractures, anemia, cancers, necrosis of the jaw. Their fight for their rights was no less horrific, but eventually their story changed history, forcing the creation of some important radiation safety regulations. Well, that was not quick, but the lessons were learned, and the radium paint then was used mostly for industrial purposes, especially widely in the Soviet Union. And that said, if you build a collection of Cold War artifacts, be very careful with Soviet items you can find on online marketplaces or at junk sale. Those can be aviation and marine clocks, diving watches, electrical switches, tourist compasses, and even Christmas decorations. The production time period in question is approximately up to the late 1960s, because after, safe, non-radioactive paints were already used. And no matter what you can find in internet about using tools and solvents, never ever try to remove the paint yourself, unless you are certified, work in a radiological lab, and have a negative pressure glove box. In the best case, you will get a few liters of liquid radioactive waste you won't be able to properly dispose of. In worst case, as the paint becomes fragile over years, you certainly will get invisible radium dust you can inhale. What will follow, you already know. So instead, contact your local nuclear regulator and dispose properly. But this was just one example. Next thing is better to keep your eye on is smoke detectors. Of course, not all, but specifically those that have a radioactive source inside. You may ask, why someone would even design something like that? Well, the answer is simple. They are superior in their sensitivity, which is very critical for some facilities. Inside, they have a very small source of alpha particles that ionize the air in a small chamber. Smoke interrupts this flow, and then the alarm sounds. In Western versions, it is typically americium, but in Soviet detectors such as RID-1 or KI-1, that was plutonium. In both cases, there are maximum micrograms of those materials, so when the detectors are intact and their lifetime didn't expire, they are relatively safe. But here is the catch. Their designated lifetime is only 6 to 10 years, and after that, they must be replaced. But not all of them have clear warning signs, or have them only inside. Because of this, or because of simple ignorance, some end up forgotten or simply discarded as trash, becoming orphan sources. If one corrodes, breaks, or is crushed, the radioactive materials can escape. As they are almost always exclusively alpha-emitting, you cannot detect them with a usual dosimeter. And to make things far worse, when ingested or inhaled, the alpha-emitting materials are the most destructive of them all, even if in micrograms. And because of chemistry of transuranic elements, they get exceptionally slowly ejected from a human body. Effectively meaning that if you get them inside, they stay forever. And so, if you find something like this, especially visibly damaged, keep the distance, do not touch, and call the authorities. We believe many of you watched the famous Chernobyl miniseries from HBO. Among other scenes, there were episodes where you can see the famous DP5V Geiger counter. And so many ask it if they can get one for a collection. Our advice is always the same, better not. This is because, along with the device, you get a check source built inside the revolving cover on its detector. When turned into the test position, it sends a steady radiation beam to the detector, allowing the operator to see whether the device is actually functioning. This source is strontium yttrium, it's sealed with epoxy and emitting only beta radiation. So, theoretically, if handled properly, it's relatively harmless. Well, harmless as much as a source can be. The catch is that DP5V were produced at least around 50 years ago, meaning that the integrity of those sources is impossible to guarantee. And then there is DP63, small, elegant, with bakelite casing and a nice holster. At first, that may look like a cool addition to your Chernobyl or Cold War epoch collection. The problem is, this little device also has a check source hidden under this clip. It is more powerful, and because of its design, it's easier to damage. But even if you're lucky and get DP-63 without it, you still cannot be sure. That's because many versions also have radium dials so reactive, they emit up to 1 millisievert per hour. But DP-2 is even worse. It also has a strontium-yttrium source, but of a size of a matchbox. While inside the device, it is well shielded, but once removed, it will emit a beam so strong that it can be detected in the distance of 15 feet or 5 meters. And to make things worse, because of its design, it becomes more and more fragile over time. This, of course, is not the complete list, but we believe you got the idea. All these devices were never meant to be used or stored for decades. So you cannot be sure if a source is intact. While the beta particles do not penetrate deeply, a prolonged exposure can burn skin, leaving wounds that heal slowly and very painfully. Especially damaging, the beta particles are for unprotected eyes. But those beta-active check sources are only for quick testing. Calibration sources that are used for fine-tuning of dosimeters are far stronger. A device is placed in a shielded chamber at a specific distance to the calibration source, exposed for a set time, and then adjusted to match the standard. And here comes the problem. Given that they are used in shielded laboratories, these sources can have truly extreme power. And depending on the purpose, emit gamma, beta, alpha, or even all together. Yet, they often look just as small pieces of metal. It can be a disc, a rectangle, or something resembling a washer. They can be packed in tiny containers, something like an inch to five in size, ironically almost always quite beautifully made. Those can be made of shiny precision machine steel, or have a shape of a thin but unusually heavy disc consisting of two parts. Or, in the case of alpha sources, containers can be made even of thick plastic, roughly resembling a clamshell container for makeup. The chance that such a calibration source is lost is very low, but still rarely it happens, because sometimes they are actually included with the device. And so, remember, if you ever find something like this, this painted or engraved radiation sign, and possibly engraved or embossed number, do not open, do not touch, and inform your local nuclear regulator. I want to underscore, these sources are not a joke, and some can certainly take your health away. And finally, the most powerful sources of all, industrial. They are vital for many processes that make our life easier. They sterilize food and medical instruments. They reveal cracks in welds that no eye could see and no instrument can access. They measure the thickness of paper, plastic, or steel. They work silently, and we all rely on them. This very object is just a tiny steel tube, which I show as a reference, because the real source may look pretty much like this. But don't be fooled, typically made from cesium, cobalt, or iridium, these objects produce radioactivity so extreme that these few seconds of holding them in hand like this would be enough for truly catastrophic effects. That's why industrial sources are never exposed, and instead they are placed in special projectors. Despite their small size, which rarely exceeds 10 inches or 25 centimeters, these containers are very heavy. In front, there is so-called collimator with a shutter that can be remotely open. And once it is, from inside shoots a very thin, focused beam of gamma radiation of an incredible power. Because of this, they are normally brightly painted and marked with warning signs. Once they reach the end of service time, they must be removed and discharged under strict supervision. Too bad, sometimes they become simply forgotten, and then they may look like this. Sometimes orphaned industrial sources may end up in metal scrapyards. Sometimes, due to malfunction, their active cores can be lost. Exactly this happened in 1981 in Kramatorsk, here in Ukraine, when a core was lost during stone production. It ended up inside a concrete panel used for an apartment block, and years later, residents began dying from cancers and leukemia. We will cover that incident in detail in another episode. In 2023 in Australia, another tiny capsule fell from a truck. It triggered a nationwide search, and fortunately, it was found. Additionally, there exist portable devices for non-destructive testing or industrial radiography, such as Soviet gamma rad. However, they exist worldwide and can look very different. They are used to test pipelines, railways, ship hulls, basically wherever wells must be flawless. And perhaps the most extreme examples are medical therapy heads used in oncology. They use the same principle, a core, a collimator, and a shield. And typically, because of extreme power of the core, the shield is made from special steel, lead, or even depleted uranium, so its weight may exceed half a ton. In these pictures, you can see how such a device being removed professionally, to be later moved into a designated facility for safe storage. But unfortunately, history knows a few cases where such machine was just left behind to be discovered by scrap hunters. The most notorious case is Goiânia, Brazil. A teletherapy head left in disused clinic. A capsule broken open by scavengers. Blue glowing dust spread through a neighborhood. This tragedy is sometimes called the Brazilian Chernobyl. Goiânia incident is a prominent example how close or fun sources actually can be to anyone, and we'll have a separate documentary about it. Well, we cannot cover every type in one video. From aircraft ice detectors to thorium welding rods, there are many, many more. But we will return to them in future episodes. And as we say in Chernobyl, you should not be afraid of radiation, but you must respect it. And so we hope that what you learned today was pretty eye-opening and will make your life safer. Stay tuned. If you want to support our work, join us on Patreon. The link is in the description below. Thank you for watching, and we will see you in the next one.